Hello, this is Angela Anderson. Thanks for joining me for this acrylic painting tutorial. In this video, I'm going to be showing you how to paint this rustic chapel. We're going to be doing it with palette knives, so it's going to be really easy and a fun project for beginners, I think. Got my husband, Mark, with me.
Hey there, everybody.
He's man in chat during our live show tonight, so if you have questions while I'm painting, you can ask those, and I will try to answer them. Let's get started. Roughly sketched out my chapel. You can see it's super simple drawing. We're oversimplifying everything tonight so that you can't really get into too much detail with a palette knife because it's just one of those tools that doesn't really allow for that. So I wanted to show you the rustic barn that we did. It's actually probably almost 3 years ago, I think. So that's available in my library of other videos here on YouTube. If you want to paint this to kind of go along with this, it's going to be similar colors and styles to that one. So I'm using a 9x12 inch canvas panel. This is a cotton canvas panel from Frederick's. I decided to go with the cotton instead of the linen because it's got a little bit more texture, and so I figured for this it would be helpful to have that little bit more grip on our canvas to grab that texture of the paints. And I pulled in all of my different palette knives. I wanted to show you, I've got a little tin that I have all my palette knives in all kinds of different sizes and shapes, some like this. So whatever you have in your palette knives, grab those. The ones that I think I'm going to be using the most tonight are probably like this one. This will be good for most of our background works, maybe some clouds if we want to add those in. So these kind of ones are good for spreading large areas of paint. And then we've got a couple more that are shaped sort of like this. You can see this one's a lot more flexible. So I use this one a lot when I'm mixing colors because it makes it easy to spread that paint on my palette. And then I can flex that paint and kind of get it off of there so I don't waste a lot of paint. This one's pretty flexible too. They're both kind of, this one's a little bit pointier than this one. So this one with the really long blade will be good for things like small details and leaves and things where you want to get just the very tip in there and can kind of make little dabs and dashes. They're not as good for spreading large areas of paint. You want something a little bit more rigid for that. So let me put those aside. That one's actually about the same size, again, kind of long and flexible. So those are good for smaller little detailed areas. You can get some like long tree branches too. We'll probably use that edge for some tree branches. I'm just kind of going over the different palette knives, kind of what they are used for, and hopefully this will be helpful. I don't know, but maybe help you choose which ones you want to grab tonight. I also got this kind of like spade looking one. It's flat, really good hard edges. So that will be good for maybe on the roof here. We will want some kind of lines and things like that. We'll probably grab that one. And then I've got this one that's kind of a similar shape to this, but it's got more flexibility. So I'll probably use it in here where I want to get in here and maybe need to use that leverage a little bit. And then we'll definitely need these little bitty ones like this for the window details and such like that. All these little bitty ones will be used quite a bit. They're not flexible at all. So they're used for really tight little areas and laying down little bits of paint at a time. And then here's another really long, nice, flexible one. This is another one that I use sometimes for color mixing, or we can use it for our long branches on our tree. We're gonna try to do the tree. I've never done a tree in palette knife, the truth be told. Well, I have done them, but not this way, not like on a background. It's going to be like this where it's really exposed. So we'll see. We may or may not like it. If we don't like it, we can paint over it, right? if you want to, you can use brushes for blocking in some of your larger colors. If you don't like using the palette knife, that's totally acceptable too. You can change it out for your brushes totally if you really prefer that look. Anything goes here. So this is kind of just supposed to be a fun project. Don't stress out about it.
So they get full credit for using their brushes?
Right. Full credit for using brushes if you
okay.
want to.
Okay. Just want to make sure.
Yeah. Same colors, pretty much same, similar techniques too, you know. So when I'm saying like skim it, then you're just going to skim it with the brush instead of with the knife. So it'll be very similar techniques. Let's go over our colors really quick. I put out my Amsterdam paints. They're a little bit softer body paints, and they'll spread a little bit easier for me. They're still fairly thick, but they'll work better for this project. I've got carbon black, burnt umber, burnt sienna. Those are our main three dark colors that we'll be using. And then yellow oxide, unbleached titanium. It's actually titanium buff in this brand. This one is called turquoise green, but it's kind of like cobalt teal that we've used quite a bit. And this one is phthalo turquoise, so that's kind of turquoise blue and green together. And then this one is phthalo blue and ultramarine blue. Not sure that we're going to use those two a whole lot since we have these already kind of pre-mixed, and our main color is going to be that turquoise blue in our background, but I thought we would go ahead and have those out just in case. Let me show you how I drew it real fast. We're not going to take a huge amount of time because, like I said, it's going to be super simple. So you just kind of want to map out your bottom area there. It's very, very low to the canvas. Because we need to use up all this space. Now, if you're not putting your tree, I would just tilt that canvas this way and use up all that good vertical space for your church spire. And then you can make your church a little bit taller. But if you're going to put your tree in, I'd do it sideways like we're doing here. I thought about doing it on a square canvas so that it'd give me a little bit more room, but I didn't like the look of it when I was drawing it out. So, all right, we're going to want to start here and not go any higher than just under, well, here's our third. We're going to go just above the third. So if we break this space into three parts here, and find this lower third, we're going to come just above that for our edge of our chapel. And then however wide you want to make it, really doesn't matter. Just make another vertical line here. And these two should be about the same length. So just kind of figure it out here. This one is a little bit higher than this one because this ground is kind of covering up some of it up this way. Like that. But you want to make sure, the main thing is to make sure that these two lines are completely vertical to the edge of your canvas. That will keep your chapel from looking like it's tilted. Okay, and then we want to find our other mark here. And so it's going to be not quite halfway as wide, so maybe just a little bit wider than half this distance here is this edge here, and then we'll figure out how tall we need to make it here in a minute. So what I want to do is do my cross line here, and this is going to be slightly diagonal to this edge, so it's a little bit higher right here. Go across like that, and this is our main kind of shape now that we're going to base all the rest of this on. So then we're going to come up here and we're going to do our top line of our chapel and just kind of figure out how tall you want your roof. It really doesn't matter. You make up, however tall you want it. So if you want to really exaggerate it, you can make it way up here, or you can make it lower and make your spire really high. It's just up to you. I kind of split the difference and just sort of split this in the middle. So I had about the same distance for my roof as I did my spire, and do your little angle here. So kind of figure out where you're going to do your angle here. And then this line is, there's actually a vanishing point way up here. It's way up. So these aren't exactly parallel, but they're really close to parallel. So don't do this one too far in, but they are coming together just slightly. And same thing with this one. This line here is coming a little bit shorter and closer to this line. It's not exactly parallel like these lines are, just because we've got a vanishing points out this way and up this way. I don't know if that made any sense to anybody, but
yeah, the vanishing points in the neighbor's yard.
Yeah, the vanishing point is in the neighbor yard.
Okay, just make sure.
they're hiding
it. It's pretty far out there.
They're hiding it over there. So this line here and this line here should be fairly parallel, but not quite perfectly parallel. They should come just slightly in. So this one should come just slightly in to this one here. As if this they were kind of meeting up somewhere in the distance. That makes sense? Okay, and so then this one here, what we're going to want to do is figure out how wide this is. So figure out how long this line is. A little bit, remember, is going down here. And the same thing for this. This is actually going to be even more exaggerated. More of that line is going to be hidden down here. So we're going to do maybe like right in here for the top of this line. Okay? Then what we're going to do is come to this corner and go all the way to where this goes down into the ground. So we got to find, kind of figure out where that's going underneath there, right? And do a cross piece like that. And then this one is going to about right there. And then do a cross piece like this. This tells us the center of our chapel on this edge. And this is where our door is going to go. So it's going to be a little bit to this side. You can see it's just slightly to this side of your drawing. And there's going to be a little bit of the door hidden right here. So there's going to be like a outline of the door there. And then there's a little section right inside right there. Okay. And then it's actually taller than this. I'm not drawing it tall enough. It's like this. It's much more exaggerated. And you can make it as wide as you want. You know, if you want your door a lot wider, you can do that. This one's got, you know, kind of a lot of vertical. It's just sort of the style of it. Okay, so there's like a little detail that's coming in here and here. These lines are going to come across straight from this line to this line. So just going to kind of go like that. And they should be at an angle to match this angle. There and there. And then all we're going to do is come out just a little bit with this and meet up with our top of our roof line there. And then you're going to find this center line and go straight up. Actually, this should be the center of our roof right here. I forgot to do that. So this is actually where the top of this would be. Sorry.
It's okay.
To do that right there. So that would be where this would meet up with this. Do a straight line up from the bottom, parallel with these two lines, and that gives you the top point of your thing. You know this is the center, so this is where our circle is going to be. It's going to be a little offset here, like that. Okay. Then our windows are going to be in here, so we just put two lines here and here, parallel with this line. And then really you could do the same thing here if you wanted to. You could do your cross piece, find out where the center is, and kind of make both of these about equal parts distance from there. And then do your window here and window here. And if you did it right, then they should be just a little bit closer to this side than this side. And there's a little bit of it that sticks out here. I'm not doing these exactly perfect, but you get the idea. Like that. And then, and really honestly, the more kind of wonky it is, a little bit more charming I find them to be. So don't, I wouldn't stress out about the drawing part. It's supposed to be rustic, which gives us an excuse to play with the dimensions and make it a little bit more, you know, not perfect. All right. So the top of the roof is going to have this little triangle thing, little box shape here. And then this one is kind of coming down here and going off the distance. You're not seeing it much. And then two straight lines up like this. And then give it a hat. Just like this. And a little cross at the top there. And then that's pretty much it. I'm going to leave a couple little spaces. There's a lot of detail in this, but I'm not going to try to do it. I'm just going to leave a couple open spaces here and here for some of the sky color to show through. And that's about all I'm going to do with that spire. And then our lines are going to follow these lines of our roof and go across like that. And there's our chapel pretty easy. And then our trees are going to be kind of wider at the bottom. They're going to come up like this, and then we're going to branch them off. These branches are going to be very straight and stick, you know, figure-y, because we're doing it with the palette knife, so we're not going to be able to get a huge amount of curve in them or, you know, detail, which is fine. And then we're going to just, I think I'm going to go ahead and put leaves, even though there's not any leaves on our trees, but we're going to kind of dabble in some greenery on our trees right here. So that's going to be really simple. All right, let's get to painting here.
So two things.
Yes.
One, I really appreciate your precise geometry. Two, I have a better joke for the vanishing point. Okay. It's at the proper social distance. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Okay.
And good, good.
We had a real question
earlier. All right, let's do it.
First, I got to find it. Hold on.
Okay.
Please hold. It is, somebody asked about what can they use to make Mars black look like carbon black?
They're pretty much identical. You're not going to be able to tell the difference, really. Carbon black's a little shinier is all, but they're almost identical. I did a comparison of them. In fact, I can grab my little thing. I don't have my black comparison. I don't know where that... I need to, and I would suggest you do this. I don't have one, and I need to. I'm going to actually just designate one of my notebooks to color mixing and just do nothing but color mixing. That way I can find when I color mix, because right now I've been just like scattering them. You know, I'll just like decide, hey, I want to do a color mixing thing, and then it'll be mixed in with all these other things that don't have anything to do with color mixing. So note to self, going to do that. Okay. That'll be. And if you see me doing it, let me know, like ask me, is that your color mixing notebook? And I'll say no, I'm sure. So here's...
And I'll get that look.
All right. Here's Mars black and carbon black. Mars black is just maybe the tiniest bit more brown. But they're both... In their darkest state especially, you're not going to see any difference to the eye, you know. So, okay.
Okie dokie.
Let's do it.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, guys.
Whew, that was a fast 15 minutes.
I'm jumping in there, going. Oh, gosh, that was not good. Sorry.
That's fine.
That hurt my ears. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and use my my blue here that I've got already mixed up. I've got white, and I'm going to mix up some of it for my sky with some white, just lightening that color up. And then I want to pull some off to the side here, and I'm going to use some phthalo blue and burnt sienna. That gives me a really beautiful teal color. It'll be a little bit more neutral than our turquoise. And if it's not neutral enough, just add a little bit more brown. We want it to be, there we go. Look at how pretty that is. Okay, so I'm just going to use these two colors for my sky. I'm not going to overmix. What I want to do, and I'm going to go ahead and use this brush. We'll see how it does. If it's too flexible, I may switch to this this one here. We'll see how it goes. So I'm going to kind of clean off. You want to have a paper towel handy. You want to clean off that bottom part of my palette knife, and then I'm just going to scrape through to get kind of a bead of paint. I've got fairly a lot, because I've got a lot of area to cover here. And I'm going to just kind of lay it down and let it skim across the canvas and leave some of the background showing. And if I leave these kind of white spots too, I really like all of this dark that's in the background here. I painted it. I don't think I mentioned that. I painted it equal parts carbon black and white. So that's what our background is. Sorry, forgot to mention that before we started here. I'm going to go right up to the roof of the church and just kind of spread it out It's okay to have the texture in there. That's fine. And the nice thing about the palette knife is that if you get some weird areas, you can go back over here and kind of smooth it out a little bit. I like all of these kind of little palette knives showing, though. I don't know if you can palette knife strokes showing like that. They kind of overlap each other and layer. It gives a really interesting look to the background. So I like to leave those in. I don't like to skim it too much. Let's just go ahead and get this on here. We're going to have to move quickly because this is such a large area. And I can already tell we're like halfway down and we've used up all of our paint. So we're going to need a whole lot more paint. That is one thing. That's why I also used these cheaper paints for this part, because I knew I was going to be using a lot of it. I don't want to use up all my really expensive paints. So if you have a cheaper brand of paint, this is the time to use it. Use it up and get your Liquitex Basics out, or one of those brands that has the kind of softer, squishier texture.
I think some of the viewers won some of those, didn't they, last year? Isn't the Amsterdam the one we gave away?
I don't remember.
I can't remember now, the way you just said that.
Could be. Yeah. Well, I know they're associated with... they're associated with Princeton Brushes, I think. Was it Fredericks? One or the other. I can't remember.
I thought we had like sets of them or something.
Well, no. That was. Oh yeah, we did. Yes, they gave me some. Yeah, I did give away some. Yes, 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 yes. Wow. They sent me some directly.
I remember something you didn't.
I know.
Never happens. I'll mark the tape.
So just using my edge of my palette there, my knife there, to get in this little area here around my church spire. That's good. The nice thing about this little kind of blunt end there, you can kind of use it to do that. I'm going to clean this part off because I got a little bit too much in that area there. I'm just going to scrape it back right there. Okay. And one of the things that you'll notice too when you're doing this is if you set your paint down and then kind of just set your knife flat and lift it, you'll get this kind of really interesting, I don't know if you can see that, really interesting texture there too. So it's got it in a few places. I'm not doing it like really on purpose, but sometimes you'll see that happening, and that's what's causing it. It's just setting your brush down into that wet paint. So if you don't like it, you can just very lightly skim back over those areas and lift it off. And I'm going to use a little bit more white down at my horizon line. That always kind of gives you a little bit more perspective of distance, just to have a little bit more white at your horizon line. I don't know why, but that's just kind of a nice little trick that you can do. So if we lighten our color down here, it'll make it look a little bit farther away.
Somebody asked, do you feel like you have a little bit more freedom using the palette knife rather than a brush?
Yes, yes, it does. And you can't control it. So you kind of just have to go into this with that kind of attitude of, we're just going to see how this goes. You know, this may not be exactly what I pictured in my head, but that's going to be okay. You know, and if you kind of go into it with the right attitude and know that it's an impressionist type medium, but an impressionist type tool, you're not going to be able to control your results like you would with a brush, it actually can be really relaxing if you let yourself just kind of get into that process and let go of the control for a little while. You know, it does really
results may vary,
right? Your results may vary, but hopefully you'll have a good time either way, you know.
You could do the same painting 3-4 times and they'd look completely different.
Oh, for sure. Yes, for sure. And you, I did that example painting, you know, of that barn. That was my example one. I don't know where the one that we did in the actual video is. No idea. Somewhere stored away. But I know that they turned out very different. So, you know, that's just how it goes with these. And this one's got a little bit more of that medium, this one here, this cobalt teal color, or the turquoise green in, what's it called? Leave as much or as little of that dark gray background showing. So, like over here, I covered it almost completely in this corner. And then up in here, I've got a little bit more. We can add other colors to it. So I could grab a little bit of my, this is my brush, my phone, I think, going off. I'm going to use some of the yellowed color. Is it my parents?
No.
Oh.
It's your middle child.
Jordan calling me?
For your birthday.
For sure. Oh, late. Tell him I'll call him back. No, he sent me a note on my birthday. He said happy birthday. Yeah. Hopefully everything's going okay. Okay. Get some more of that color. And so now I'm going to turn this because it's just going to be easier to get right up next to this. And I'm going to come right up next to it and just pull back. I'm using that edge. There you go. There we go. And then I'm going to put some of this color over here so that this is not the only place on the canvas that has it. And this paint is starting to get a little bit sticky, so you don't want to mess with it too much while it's trying to dry. And it will take a little bit longer for this to dry, obviously, because it's thicker. So I'm just going to go ahead and use this white that we've got over here and maybe change out to a brush that's got a little bit rounded tip. So I'm going to set this one aside and grab my rounded tip brush, and I'm going to, it's kind of smoothed out, but I haven't over blended it with the palette knife. It's good to kind of leave a little bit of these, colors happening, all these different colors, so don't over blend it, and then you can kind of get these really interesting things where you've got this you know, this mark here that's got like 4 different variations of the same color in it. It's kind of makes it more interesting. Okay, so I'm going to put a cloud right here. So what I want to do, I want my cloud to be kind of wispy on both sides, so I'm going to start kind of in the middle of the cloud, and then I'm going to push, and I'm going to very lightly just skim that paint that is on the tip of my brush and let it catch and see how it's doing. It'll create all these kind of really interesting shapes. I'm just barely touching it down. It's almost like you're kind of patting a baby. You don't want it to, you're not scraping here. You're just kind of touching and tapping and creating some texture, and we're getting that kind of raised texture, like I mentioned, you know, that happens when you kind of touch and lift off the wet paint. I don't know if you can see that, but getting all this really interesting stuff happening here. So I'm going to just kind of do sort of a cloud shape over here. It's not in our picture, but, you know, we're just going to play with it and add what we want. Maybe do some down here. Now this is going to have most of our trees, so we're not going to need a whole lot back in here. Actually, I'm just going to smooth that out a little bit. Okay, there we go. So we'll leave that kind of to be our main cloud shape there. Mm-hmm. I think that'll be good enough. You're going to need lots of paper towels for this, so
So I have shamed our son to joining the chat.
Oh, is he joining chat?
I was like, what, you weren't watching?
Jordan. You just calling to say hi? Yeah. They're too far away. Well, Mississippi, it's kind of... It's when things like this happen, I just like the mama bird comes out of me and just want all my chicks under the same roof. I really want to roost them right now. I'm just like, come home.
Come home.
I'm trying to talk Nathan, our oldest, into working from home here. Like, I don't care. Bring your cat. Just come here. Just be here with me.
Let's go.
It's the mom. It's the mom coming out.
Yeah.
It's totally impractical, I know. And I don't really expect them to do it, but I still, that part of me wants them here.
Well,
no matter how old they are, he's almost 30.
It's our own fault for growing up.
Huh?
It's our own fault for growing up.
Exactly, exactly. They're grown up and contributing to society and independent and doing really well, and I hate it. No. No, I don't. I love it. But part of me, the mom part of me, is like, kills me. All right. Let's see. I think I'm going to put some burnt sienna down here in the grassy area, just kind of as an undertone. So I'm going to grab that burnt sienna, and let's grab the cobalt teal. I think those will be pretty together. It's kind of a dark greenish. But I'm going to do more brown than green here. Maybe add just a little bit of white. And very little, and I'm just gonna maybe a little bit more white. There we go. I'm just gonna scrape that in down here. It's not gonna be a very pretty color yet. We'll add more green to it later, but this will be kind of our undertone for our grasses. There's a lot of brown in this picture in our foreground. Jordan just calling to say hi?
I think so.
Good. Liam is our little grandbaby, is Jordan's son. His, let's see, he was one in January.
January.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Just a little bit over one, getting into all kinds of stuff. It's awesome. So cute. He's like the cutest baby ever.
Of course. Takes after his grandpa.
Yes, exactly. Takes after his dad, Teo Jat. Jordan was the cutest baby. All of my boys were the cutest babies.
Sorry, everybody.
Yeah.
We didn't want to let you know that.
Too bad. If you thought your kids were the cutest. That's okay. That's all right. You can feel that way.
Yeah.
You'd be wrong, but no. Totally joking. Not really, but kind of. All right.
Welcome
cleaning
to the
that
channel
off.
While we abuse you.
I added a little bit more yellow down here. What'd you say?
Welcome to the channel where we abuse you.
Yeah. So let's just work from top down here on our chapel. That way I can avoid getting my hand stuck in it, maybe. Mark's laughing because that's not...
Got to start something new, huh? Wow.
Cruel.
Well, I'm remembering the show last night. Boy, that's really bad looking.
Last night?
Know, yeah. That 100 Human show we were watching.
Oh, yeah. What was it? I don't remember.
The negative comments versus the positive comments.
Oh, right. Yes. That's right. Yeah. I thought that was really fascinating. They, I'll mention it here in a minute. But so that's the teal mixed with the yellow oxide. It's actually making a really pretty green there. So that would be like phthalo blue and phthalo green together. Or you could just use phthalo blue and this yellow oxide. You'd get something similar, maybe a little bit brighter. Could add a little bit of brown to it if you wanted to tone it down. I'm going to grab some burnt sienna and mix up some of that with this green. Make kind of a rust color because I'm seeing some of that on the roof. Maybe add a little bit more yellow to it.
Somebody wanted to know about the blue. Uh-huh. They said, would it work to use two blues in the sky, or should they wait until it dries?
Yes, you totally could. I kind of did use two blues. I used this blue here, and then I used the phthalo blue and burnt sienna mixture. And all I did was kind of overlap them a little bit, you know, and just kind of layer them. If you're going to use really different blues, then you may want to let one dry a little bit, or then you can kind of smoosh them together a little bit and blend them together. If you overlap them while they're wet, they're going to blend a little bit. So that's kind of a neat look. If you want them to be a little bit more distinct, then let them dry in between. So, okay, let me see. I don't know if I like this. I kind of think I want to go a little bit, I'm going to get a little bit more creative with my colors. So I'm going to grab some of this unbleached or burnt, or not unbleached titanium. This is called titanium buff. Here, I'm going to mix a light green with it. So that'll be kind of our corroded, our patinaed metal. Not corroded, but I know it makes it sound really bad. Patina is a much, much more like artsy sounding name, you know, for corroded. Okay, so getting some of that turquoise, that light turquoise color there. And if you want to make that like turquoise, you just take a turquoise green and add white to it. So that's all that is. So use like a cobalt or phthalo blue, phthalo green, and some white, and you'd get something similar to that. You could get it, you probably can't get a really good turquoise with an ultramarine blue because it's got too much purple in it. But if you used like a cerulean blue or a phthalo blue, or even phthalo blue with yellow would make a turquoise because it's got a lot of green in it already. Okay. Let me see what I'm doing here. Just talking about color mixing a lot.
You're painting, but that's okay. This is a painting channel, so color mixing is a good topic. I think
I'm going to grab this one. I'm going to mix up some of the burnt umber with my ultramarine blue, and I'm doing about 50-50 here. This will make a really pretty gray. Depending on how much blue or brown you use, it'll go more of a blue gray or more brownish gray. So it's a really great gray to mix really beautiful colors. And I'm going to use that kind of as our base gray. Kind of turned out a little bit more brown than I intended. This brown, I think, is a little bit, doesn't have as much black in it as, oh gosh, that's sorry. So I'm going to take a little bit of it and I'm going to add some blue to this one and make kind of more of a blue version. Right there.
And just to mention, if you don't have palette knives, there's some in Angela's list on the Brush Guys.
I do, yes. In my list on the Brush Guys, I also have some in my Amazon store. These ones here with the blue handles that are the Liquitex. They come in a set of several, and I really like them, but they're very, very, very flexible. So, and they don't have this little bitty one, so you're going to want that. That's the Frederick 7060 or the one at the Brush Guys. I can't remember the name of it.
We have Italy
Chelsea,
paint.
Chelsea.
Ryan Italy paint knife.
I can't tell.
Italy paint knife.
What?
You got Italy paint knife, Ryan Italy paint knife.
Does it have a size?
3/4 inch, 1/5/8.
3/4 inch would three probably
and,
be this.
3 1/4 inch by 1/2 inch, and another one is by 3/8 inch. So anyway, check it out.
It's the smallest one. It's the smallest one on the list. Okay. Yeah, if it tells you the measurements, it'll be the smallest one. So I added way more of the brown there. You can see how the brown that white made it. I'm going to get some more ultramarine here.
Yes, and you want flexible, right?
Flexible is good for some things, you know. If you want to scrape it, then the non-flexible one like this would be good.
Okay.
All right, so there we go. There's that blue-gray that I'm looking for. Nice. Okay. Now you can tell kind of the underlying color when you add white to it. So that's the color that I want there. So I'm going to use this color, and I'm just going to kind of use them both. I'm going to scrape off the extra and then run it through so I get a bead of paint on one side. That'll give it a little bit more control over how much goes down on the canvas here. Ooh. I'm just going to go ahead and do this whole section here. Go ahead.
Somebody asked, is a metal palette knife better than a plastic? Or
it is, and yeah, I think it is. It really gives you a little bit more control. But it's a plastic one. I used plastic ones for years, so, you know, but I did notice a difference when I did switch to the metal. They're just a little bit better.
Kind of like using regular plastic knives versus metal knives.
Right, exactly. Just a little bit more control.
It gets the job done, but...
Right.
But there's no shame. Again, no points lost.
Exactly. I'm going to go across here and just kind of add these little lines in it, too. You can see that. We'll be adding more of the lighter color on there, too. I probably ought to have a brush that's got a better point to it, but I'm just being lazy here because I already had this one out. I'm going to go I'm going over the edge. You can see kind of messing up that edge a little bit so it's not like perfect because that'll kind of be more the look of this with the kind of open, a little bit more messy. And this one goes over the edge of that. Again, if you kind of run it just very lightly over that edge, you can get kind of some of these little broken pieces of paint that kind of go over the edge a little bit and kind of mess up that edge. And we're going to do some highlights in this, too. So I'm going to switch to, let me think, what brush do I want? Let's do this light, long one here. I can get kind of some of this lighter gray on here. I'm going to get a little bit of the darker, and then I'm going to pick up this lighter gray that we mixed from this color using the unbleached titanium and white. I think there was a little bit of white in there. I'm just going to set it down and lightly pull it across, and then move over and set it down and lightly pull it across. And just keep doing that for these little tiles on the roof. And keep that same angle all the way across. And this long brush kind of makes it easier to get that look. I'm gonna get some down here. At this bottom edge here, because the bottom edge didn't quite go on. Get it right next to that bottom part there. There we go. You see that? I think it's kind of shiny the way the light's hitting it. It's a little bit hard to see it. I'm going to get some of the lighter color, maybe a little bit of this green. Run it through, get it on that edge there. Just a little bit of it. I'm gonna actually wipe this clean so I don't have a lot of stuff happening down here. Make it easier to control where I'm putting this. And run it through so I have just a little bit of paint right there. And then we're going to see do that. And I might even pull it this way. A little bit. Maybe wipe that clean and just run it through. Drag that down a little bit.
So one of our viewers.
There we go. We just kind of mushed it all together. See that? What, one of our viewers, what?
Has noticed that the time for this Saturday's video is not its normal time.
Yeah, I had it earlier, and I need to switch that back because my friend was having their wedding, and it got postponed. So
why?
Her son's wedding got postponed.
I wonder why.
Yeah, sadly. Along with all everything else in our lives right now is on hold, isn't it? Thankfully, we were already working from home, so it hasn't affected us too much. Somebody was, I get this email from another YouTuber, and he does, he has YouTube channels, and his YouTube channel is about, you know, basically how to make your YouTube channel better, you know, the best it can be kind of thing. And he was like, we were already quarantined, didn't know it. We were already living the quarantine lifestyle. I was like, yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. I'm not going out any less than I ever did right now. Mm-hmm. Mark's, I think, feeling it more than I am. He's used to being out and doing stuff. I'm going to put that rusty color right along that bottom edge there. I'm just adding that. And so let's work on this little spire here. I'm going to get the smallest brush here and get some of this gray. I'm going to use some of the gray-blue that we used on the roof and some green here and just put that in. Just drawing with it. I'm going to start with the darker color. I'm going to put that there. Put the lighter color at the tip there. Let's do a little dot. Scrape up a little bit on the tip here and do a little dot for the top there. And grab some of this green. Let's spread out the edges a little bit over the top of our blue sky.
Okay, now I'm pretty convinced that they found something on Oak Island.
Really? Why?
Because they must have unleashed the curse.
they unleashed the curse?
Mm-hmm. Just saying.
Could be. Could be. All right, I'm going to get this little guy here, and I'm going to scrape up just a little bit of paint right there on the little tip. I don't know if you can see that little roll of paint. I'm going to use it right here, and I'm going to use it just at a slight angle. There, make our line, and then I'm going to use it here. And the line is actually tilted, so we can kind of go along with this angle here. There. Tilt it a little bit. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and use this. I have to use this right here. Put in our little church steeple here. Again, kind of roughen up that edge a little bit here. It's not perfect. Getting a little bit of this dark, this green going along that edge right there and highlighting it. Pulling it up a little bit. And then I want to put a little bit of this blue on the inside of our steeple. So I'm trying to mix up a color that's similar to the sky that's near it. And I'm going to use this one again because it's going to be about the right width. Here, scrape a little bit of paint right there. And I'm just going to use it and set it down. Pull it a little bit. There and there. There we go. Okay, and I think I'm going to pretty much leave that as is. I don't think I'm going to do a whole lot on. As far as highlights and things go, this area is darker right here. So if we want to go back in here and darken up this area, you can for this coming down onto the roof right here. Like that. And then there is kind of a highlight right along where that hits. So we can maybe do a little bit of this green kind of on one side here and there. Very messy, but a lot of fun too. I'm gonna come up a little bit higher. I'm going to get the medium-sized one now, and I'm going to go ahead and put a little bit of color right along this edge here. And now that this is dry, I think, well, it's almost dry. It's not quite dry. Never mind. We'll just keep working on our...
Scratch that.
Scratch that, yeah. I thought it was dry, but it's not. Building here, and I'm gonna mix up some of the unbleached titanium and some of the yellow oxide and white. I got a little bit of green in there somehow too, that's okay. I'm gonna do a lot of yellow on this chapel here. And I'm just going to spread it on like butter. Leave a little bit of that background gray showing, maybe mostly just like around the roof line area. It's got a lot of green in there. Use some white with this burnt sienna too. It had a little bit of that yellow on there. I'm going to use it to do some of the details there. And then I'm going to use the darker burnt sienna. If I can get some that's clean. There we go. To do our doors. I'm going to put those in so I know where to kind of paint around. And it's really kind of flat on one side and then a semicircle up to that flat. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm making a mess here. Top of that is rounded. And your bottom edge is straight.
So on Angela's birthday, she made us play board games.
I did.
And she chose to play Pandemic.
It's one of my favorite games. I was playing it before all this happened.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to win, though. I don't know if that's a metaphor for life, but... Yes, we did. We played Pandemic, and we played Carcassonne, and... Mm-hmm. Code names, or code words. Is it code words or code names?
Code words, code I think. Words. That okay. one.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to do a little bit of highlight on here, even though it's not really in our picture, just because I want to.
There we go. Somebody asked, do you ever use heavy gel or modeling paste?
No, but you can. Yeah, that's a good idea for this, especially if you don't have the heavy body acrylics. It's a good way to get this look with other kinds of paint, thinner paints. Using a dark gray there to do our little details on our church.
What I notice is that you're just angling and trying different edges and parts of the
Yes.
palette knife, mm-hmm. depending on where you're wanting to go and what you right. want it to look like. So there is no rule. It's just however you think is going to be the best.
Yeah, you're just wanting to control where that paint is on here. And if you're finding it hard to control it, then wipe it clean every now and then. And just scrape up a little bit of paint right along that edge. And that gives you much more control over where it's going. And then if you want to say, like right here where I want a straight line, then I'm going to put that painted edge right along that line. And I want it just slightly angled. I'm not putting it straight this way. I'm angling it just a little bit so that when I pull it down, that paint that's right along that edge is going to catch the canvas and come off my knife. And then I can use the tip of the brush to kind of spread it around. But like around these, I'm going to come down as close to them as I can get, and then I'm going to work around them the same way I'm going to turn it and work around it this way with that painted edge right there. Do all of these edges. And I'm going to put this yellow underneath, but this is probably going to be covered up by a lot of white, too. But I want a little bit of yellow base. So, and then I can do this edge. Oops. Got the back end of my brush in here. There we go. Oh, it's taking longer than I thought it was going to.
I am shocked. You're usually spot on with the length of these videos.
Mm-hmm. Are you mocking me right now?
Absolutely not.
Yes. Yes, you are.
Maybe just a little.
Maybe just a little. Maybe just a lot. Okay, just a good white here. What?
Said I'm just as good at estimating that as you are time, so.
Yeah.
But we're having fun. That's all that matters.
Exactly.
A little break from all the
craziness.
Craziness.
Yes. Break from watching the news and making yourself stressed out. I decided I'm going to go once a day and just watch like the main CDC thing, and that's it. And maybe the governor. But like, I stress myself out if I read stuff all day long. And as long as I'm doing the right things and staying home and being smart, I think it's all you can do. And the rest is just worry. And worry doesn't help anybody.
True that. So we'll focus on painting.
Right. Not that worry doesn't, you know, I mean, if you're being stupid, then worry, a little worry is good for you. So if you're...
But that kind of goes with anything in life.
I'm just saying, that's true. Not just this situation.
Right. I'll just stop right there.
Talking to Mark right now. Is that what you're...
No. I was just thinking of a lot of activities that people do that... There's a guy at work, and I've seen it before. In many other places, like, if you're going to be dumb, you better be tough. So, just saying.
Yeah. I like that saying.
Ooh, somebody had asked a pink question. They want to know, is raw sienna a good substitute for burnt sienna?
It's more yellow. It's a yellow, but it's a beautiful color. It's similar. It's more similar to the yellow oxide than it is to the burnt sienna. Burnt sienna is more of a reddish tone. So you could use like raw sienna and like a red iron oxide or something, and you get something similar to burnt sienna. Okay, gonna use the white now, and I'm gonna just kind of run it through with this yellow a little bit to mix it slightly, but then just I'm blowing it pretty thick with paint, and I'm just gonna spread it across here. Just barely touching it, so it's skimming the canvas here. I'm trying to highlight all of this. I'm going in different directions here with the paint, so it's going to have all these kind of different angles to it. So I'm trying to kind of go back after I put it on and sort of somewhat smooth it out so it's sort of going in the same direction, you know, so we don't have all these, you know, different angles happening with it. But what are you laughing at?
Oh, and you had, for some reason, put the titanium buff paint over here, so I just picked it up and was looking at it, reading the label, and I started laughing like, man, they don't know how to spell. But then realized it was different languages on there.
Oh.
I'm American, so I'm sorry. I'm used to seeing English first. But it has Titan Buff, all one word with two A's in it.
Oh, wow.
And then Donker.
And you were like,
What is that?
What is that?
Yeah. But then the next line is Titan Buff Deep. Oh, okay.
There we go.
And Buff Titan.
Well, Amsterdam is not an American company.
What?
They're from the Netherlands or something.
Amsterdam is not in the United States?
Exactly. So, there you go.
Wow.
I'm getting this greenish burnt umber color that we used down here, adding my yellow from right here, and I'm going to use it on my brick down here. There's like a little bit of brick right here. I'm just going to try to keep it sort of straight across right there. And I used a little bit of it up in here too. So a little bit like across right there. I might do a little bit of this brown. There we go. Kind of a shadow underneath the roof line there. It might be a little bit too much. As we're just blending those two colors together a little bit. I pulled down and then I'm pulling back up now with the whitish color. And get a little bit more of that whitish color and kind of bring it up. Okay. I'm making this one a little bit whiter than that one. Whiter. Not whiter. Whiter. Keep cleaning off your brush when you're doing this.
Palette knife.
Sorry, palette knife. Thank you. Have I said that about a bazillion times already?
Not as bad as balls, but yeah.
I figured. I'm in good company, though. I watched a ginger cook video earlier today just to kind of see how she did it, and she was calling it a brush too, so it's like, okay, I'm not the only one that does that. I love Ginger, she's funny. All right, gonna use the very tip of the brush here and just do a line.
Palette knife
there, sorry. Do a line across here where I want that windowsill to be. And I might use a shorter brush here so I can get kind of a smaller area. There we go. And get it the width that I want it to be across there. There we go. And if you want to get fancy, you could go all the way around it too. I don't think I'm going to do that. I'm going to scrape off underneath it, though. Just a little bit. There we go. Give it a little shadow. See that? This one's a little bit crooked. Could come up a little bit. It's kind of hard to fix things, though, with this. You kind of almost just have to leave it, even if it's not quite right. Because the more you mess with it, the more chances you have of really messing it up. So,
kind of like me.
You're going to get it just it good enough and leave it. This is kind of what you're saying.
Yep.
All right. There we go. Kind of just making some like little patterns here, almost like bricks too. All right. Let's move on to the front side here now. Kind of started it and then kind of gave up, moved over the other. Going to get some more white here. Just mix it in with this. Maybe get some of this unbleached titanium. And I've got a lot of it on my brush here. Let's see how I may. Too much. There we go.
Do you know what would make one palette knife better than another? I'm not sure if they're meaning like between like brands. Metal, plastic, or brands or anything like that. So
I don't. I really don't.
I would say that they probably have different thicknesses of metal.
There's certain ones too. You want to look at this thing here because I have some where this comes apart, and that's not. You don't want that. So the better ones are going to have better bonds. If you get those super cheap ones, which I got rid of all my super cheap ones because basically every time you used them, the handle wanted to fall off. Mm-hmm. So you kind of get what you pay for, I feel like, with art supplies a lot of times. Sometimes you're paying for the brand, you know, but a lot of times those better brands are going to just have better quality in general anyways. So, you know, I always opt for getting the better, you know, the better quality. I don't think you have to go back out and buy like a $30, you know, palette knife though. I think this Liquitex set has been good. They have good bonds in there. They're really strong. They're not going anywhere. I've been very happy with these ones that are in the Amazon store. I think they have different sizes too. My Frederick's ones have been good in general. I've liked them. Some of them, the cap did come off, but it went right back on. The handle didn't get loose though. So But and the ones that I bought off of the Brush Guys too have done just fine. This one and this one both are really good quality, so I've been happy with those.
So, like you said, it's just like any other tool. Yeah, there's some really expensive ones out there that will last you forever, but you may not need that.
Yeah, yeah. Depends on how much you're going to be doing palette knife work too. You know, if you're going to be doing it a lot, then you might want to get a better one. But if you're only going to do a painting once every couple months or 3 months or twice a year or something, then you don't need to invest in a bunch of them, you know. All I have to say with the different sizes is it just makes it a little bit easier to be able to have options for fitting them into these little areas. You know, I'm finding that certain ones are just working better. So it's nice to be able to have all these different sizes at my disposal to grab them when I need, you know, to fit them into these areas here. Okay. Go down here and I'm going to leave just a little bit of that dark gray between these two sections here.
Done this tip in other videos too, which is the use of old credit cards and
yes, and you can cut like up cut up credit cards and use those. Different sizes will work.
Just tell your significant other that you're cutting up the credit cards.
Old gift cards work too. That's what I usually used. I'm going to get some of this brick color because it's down here too. And my door is a little bit crooked here, so I'm just going to kind of work on it straight right here. And then it rounds out right here. Just keep turning it so that you've got the controls in the tip of it. So you always want that to be kind of your edge where the paint is being applied. Got a little bit in the sky there, but it's gonna wipe off. And then the little circle at the top is right in here too. Right above the door. It's kind of an oval there. You can make it as big as you want. Might kind of exaggerate mine a little bit bigger than it is in my picture. And maybe bring my door up just a little bit more, too. And then I'm going to do that inside of the door right here. Just like a little bit lighter color right along that inside of the door right there, and you can get that darker color and come back in here and kind of to touch it up. It's working pretty good, I think. And you can always come back in and get your clean white and clean up these edges here. If you're getting over your edge. And put some of this color in other places. There we go. I feel like my door is leaning. This needs to come over this way is the problem. This here is... there, it's rounded. Just looking at my reference photo here. So this is rounded right there. There we go. And I'm going to use that white just with the tip of the brush there, or the tip of the knife here, and put my little highlight at the top there. Let's go ahead and highlight the top of these too. Just loading up the very tip there. Carefully drawing it in there where I want. That highlight to go at the top of the windows. This one looks like it's leaning a little bit. I want to bring this edge in a little bit. There we go. So it straightens it out a little bit. Tricky. There we go.
But like you said, the non-control and wonkiness adds to the charm.
Exactly.
Like me.
Yes, like you.
I'm a lot like painting.
You gotta just say it is what it is sometimes. Oops, sorry, I was up there high.
Oops,
sorry. Didn't know I was off camera there. I'm gonna catch the texture of the paint here. Just so if you want to catch the texture of the paint and just kind of add just a little bit, just get a little bit on the edge here, just very little. There and just kind of set it almost flat, and it'll kind of grab wherever the raised areas of that canvas are.
You're just skimming it on?
Mm-hmm, just barely skimming it. Okay, I think that's pretty good. Pretty happy with that. So let's work on our tree. And I'm gonna get, let's see, what do I want? Let's go ahead and use one of my longer ones here. Yeah, let's use this one to see how it goes. So I'm going to use the brown. I'm going to use this dark burnt umber color that we mixed before. Burnt umber and ultramarine blue. Maybe grab some of that blue color from the roof. I think I'm just going to put one tree. And maybe put it just a little bit closer to the... to the church there. Okay. So just starting out with it along that edge and just kind of ran it up, pulled over a little bit. And then at the bottom, I kind of wind it out a little bit. I'm going to turn it around and do the same thing on the other side. So however wide I want my tree trunk here. There we go. Again, leaving all these nice weird things happening along the sides. You get some brown. I still have that dark color in here. I can get some white, brown, and I'm gonna come up here and just pick a side that's our highlight side and just do some. I'll go right down into the grass because we haven't put our grass in yet, so I don't have to worry about covering it. There we go. And then, so let's start kind of just running some lines here for some branches. Scraping it flat and then just getting a little bead of paint along one side here. Some of these are going to be thicker than others. And if you get too much paint, we can just put some tree and or put some branch, some greenery over it. So I wouldn't worry too much about that. But you mainly want your, obviously, your branches to get whiter as they go down and thinner as they come out. It's the way of a tree, right? So keep that in mind when you're doing this. Just kind of put your branches in, kind of crisscross them, but keep in mind the thickness. Keep the wider ones down towards the base of the tree. All right, let's get this one. This one's kind of smaller. I'm going to spray these. Get a little bit thick. Press it flat and run it through with the side. There we go. And it's fine. It's going to skip around. That's okay. Don't need these to be completely filled in. And they have lots of green in between, so. Oops, now that's a little bit much there. I'm just gonna have to widen that whole thing out a little bit. Say, doing trees with a palette knife is not for the faint of heart. it's a little bit trickier. Okay, so I'm thinking I like that. We can put some of the lighter highlight colors on some of these bigger ones. A rounded tip brush here. Make sure it's clean. This one's got a bunch of stuff on it. If your palette knife is getting all gummed up with paint, you can use alcohol to get it off if it's already dried on there. I'm going to use that green that we mixed up before. That was that turquoise and yellow oxide. I'm going to add some of the cobalt teal to it, and I'm going to tap it and create this kind of textury thing. And I'm just going to tap it and run it kind of in circles. Very little paint on here to start with. Tapping it like this will kind of control the amount of paint. It can't get too much paint on it by doing that. So I'm going to get some of that lighter color too that we used up here. Fun. Okay. Very, very primitive looking. This is not a realistic tree. It's not supposed to be. So that's the whole idea behind these kind of rustic looking ones. So just kind of know that going in. And now I'm going to put some highlights in, and I'm going to leave some space in between the highlights so we can create some pockets of darker color in our tree. There we go. I kind of got kind of over heavy-handed over there. So what I'm going to do is get some of my sky color. And kind of put some of my sky color back in over here. Where I got some too much of that green. Okay, not bad. Now I want to add just a little bit of this green into my building. So I'm just going to use it, just kind of very lightly run it across in a couple places to kind of tint some of the colors in here. Of our building here. Get some of this brown color and add it in there. Use this brown, scrape it up along that edge, and I'm gonna kind of highlight that little area right there. There's kind of that pipe coming down there. We can outline our windows if we want to a little bit. Maybe put a little bit of darker color right underneath the windowsills. Maybe a little bit in the window here. Darken it up. Along that bottom edge a little bit. You can do the inside of the doorway if you need it. Might do a little bit along this side of the doorway. Kind of a shadow right there. Put a little bit of this bright green, white almost right here. It's got that green in it. And if your paint's getting sticky, then you can just let it dry completely and then add this, because you don't want to scrape off your under layers. I do want to add another little layer of white here, because you can see how much that white dulled down there once it's dried. So I'm going to add a little bit more white to my clouds. I'm just going to tap through, and just like we did the tree, just get a little bit of it on there and just tap in. Add a second layer of white to my clouds there. Really pretty. And I might add a little bit of like a brighter yellow green. Maybe get a little bit of that cobalt teal and yellow. Some more white. Do a brighter yellow green on our tree. If you have yellow, you could add it. If you wanted a real bright yellow. Yellow green, I mean. Go just a little bit brighter. Again, kind of just tap it. Tap and kind of run it flat side there. Like it. Okay, let's use this in these greens now in our grass. And we're gonna tap it. Go up over the top of our edge of our building. Get some of the lighter color too. With the palette knife too is you just kind of want to go slow. You don't want to add too much too quickly. It's kind of like it is, you know, doing clouds or any other thing like that where you're wanting lots of layers. If you put it on too thickly too quickly, there's really not a whole lot you can do with it afterwards. So just kind of building up your layers slowly is really important. So take your time. It may take, you know, 3-4 passes to get it just right, and that's okay. Sometimes you might get it on the first pass, you never know. But I'm finding, you know, if you load your brush right, you'll have a little bit more control over what it looks like at the end. So I'm gonna just lay some of the lighter green in there, those highlights. There we go. And there's actually that little bench there. We could probably try to get that in there. What? No? Mark's like,
I hope it's not a beach bench.
Shut up. maybe it's a bad idea. Is it a bad idea? I don't know. We could do a swing. Let's do a little swing in the tree. That'd be cute.
All right.
Let's do a little swing right here. Right there, and then get the brush that's got the long edge.
So somebody's asked, compared to the golden paints, how is the Amsterdam paint, like as far as skimming and things like that? Is it a little bit easier to use?
Yeah, softer, it's easier to use because it's a little bit thinner. So there we go. I got a little too thick on that. On that string there. A little pinch, a little swing. Cute. You can leave the swing out if you don't like it. Won't hurt my feelings. But yeah, they're definitely using the softer body paints are just a little bit easier to control, I think. They flow on a little bit better too. You know, they're just smoother and a little easier to use.
Okay, I'm gonna ask you a question.
That paint underneath was dry, so I'm just gonna wipe off a little bit of that brown right there. This is not dry though. What? Ask what question?
Should the tree roots go off the bottom of the canvas now that you put a swing in there?
Why?
Because the swing looks like really, really big compared to the church. Because it looks like they're on the same line, the same plane.
Well, great. Thanks a lot.
Hey, I didn't go off script and put in a swing. On all, that's okay, all I'm saying.
Let's make it smaller.
It was a question.
No, you're right.
Okay.
You're right. I didn't think of it. Well, no, the roots wouldn't be. I mean, it could be. Yeah, the roots would be down here.
It'd make the tree look like it's like closer to us.
It wouldn't be off, I don't think, but it would be, yeah, it would probably be in front a little bit. Well, we can just make this a little bit smaller. This is like a three-person swing. Like the little bench was a three-person bench. It's about the same size as the bench.
Okay.
It was smaller than the bench was. So that's why I made it that small, but that size. But yes, you can. Okay, so there's a little bit less. And we'll do it a little bit more narrow here. There we go.
A three-person swing, which should only be used by one person at a time right now.
You probably have made it a tire swing.
Ooh, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to call that good before I mess it up even more. No, it looks good. Over here. I'm going to get a little bit of that background green here, add some white, and just clean up this area just a little bit. Add some. Yeah. So you can mess with it a little bit as long as you kind of blend it in, you know. And that background was dry, so it was allowing me to kind of move it around a little bit. But otherwise, if that background was wet, we could have had a harder time of that. But so I would wait to do your tree and your swing and everything or whatever you decide to put there until it's completely dry, and that way you don't have to worry about lifting anything off. Okay, call that good. Oh, it's cute. Yeah. Super cute. Definitely rustic-ish, you know. It's not perfect, that's not the point.
No, but that is awesome.
Okay, here's them side by side. You can kind of see the... This one, definitely, we used different blues in the sky. So, I'm not sure what colors those were. That was probably phthalo blue, more phthalo blue in the sky than this one. This one's more of the teals. So, if you want them to match, you can kind of maybe watch this one first and then try to match your colors up a little bit more. But I think they look cool. They're definitely the same style. I like how the tree turned out. It turned out better than I thought it would. So, I thought it was fun and not hard. Doing it that way is the key, though. Kind of loading your brush that way so that you've got that kind of stippled, loading it straight up and down like this and just kind of flattening it out on the palette edge so that you don't have a whole lot on there when you're kind of scrubbing it on. It makes a difference. And then if you wanted to, you could go back in and use one of these brushes that's got like a flexible tip, one of the palette knives, sorry, that's got a flexible tip. And use it, the paint just right at the very tip of it, and then dab in some little individual leaves if you want to get super fancy with it, you know, and give it a little bit more controlled look, you know. So that's a possibility too. All right, have fun with it. Hope you guys try it. If you liked it, give it a thumbs up. Share it with me on social media. Subscribe to our channel, hopefully, if you liked it and want to come back and see more. We've got tons of videos, probably over 400 now. I don't know. It was getting close to 400 last time I checked, so I have no idea how many we have, but it's a lot. And we've been doing this for several years. We love it. We like doing it live so that we can kind of interact with you guys and answer questions and get to know you a little bit. It's really fun for us. So exactly. We appreciate you guys and hope you're staying safe and making smart choices. And we will be back on Saturday at our normal time. So 2 p.m. Saturday. And I'll change that time on the schedule because it's wrong right now. But we're going to be painting a mama and baby lamb. So it'll be in time for Easter. This is kind of a pre-Easter painting too. So both of those are kind of going to be on our Easter theme this year. Last year we painted a little bunny and chick. So if you're interested in that, you can check that out. Lots of fun projects over the years that we've done. Did a baby pig last year too. Those kind of, I don't know, that's not really Easterish.
Yes, you said not really Easter.
But we do have a finger painting nest that is perfect for doing with kids. So it's a little finger painted nest with eggs. I definitely would recommend that one if you're home with kids and don't know what to do and have a few paints laying around. It's super easy. You can do it on paper even. So all right, that's it. We'll be back. And thanks for watching today with us, and we'll see you next time. Bye.